So now I want to talk about some of the things that I talked about earlier, which is with the church hopping thing. Like, for example, I gave a recommendation to places like Unitarian Universalism, Quakers, Center for Spiritual Living, anything that's New Age and not too weird. The New Age scale, I find tips in favor of like social coordination. It's really aesthetics. The more socially awkward the people who are putting it on are, the usually the worse the New Age stuff you get, or the younger the people are in spirituality and in the study of things, or the less studied they are from any kind of like primal source, the more that their sources of inspiration are like people recently who write about their ideas about things. I recommend primary sources to anybody who wants to study spirituality. The real scriptures of each of the major world religions are the ones that contain all the real secrets, and there's a lot in there that you have to wade through. It's just like any other book. You just read it, and what is important sticks, and what's not falls away. That is how human beings work. So, like, for example, that's usually a criticism of how people read the Bible. Guess what? That's how people read their newspaper. Today I want to talk about good points for bad religions. So basically, the aesthetic components of groups like Mormonism or Catholicism, and specifically Mormonism and Catholicism, are the two that I'm going to cover today, just for reasons of brevity. So let's just go right into that. So first of all, Mormonism is batshit craziness in a lot of things. They have a belief that is now, it was very popular. It was a cottage industry in the early 1800s. A lot of people were into it, and it was used as a sort of spiritual propaganda to justify the seizure of all of the Americas, basically, from the natives who were already here. Because obviously, if you have studied the teachings of Jesus, the treatment of those people and the seizure of their land does not exactly line up with the teachings in the gospel. It's actually antithetical to them. So that's one of the things that goes along with that. But that the Mormons are based on this thing called the Book of Mormon and this experience of this guy Joseph Smith and everything else, and I'm not going to go into that right now. But here's the point. They believe that all Native Americans, and made this up in the 1820s to fit with the narrative of this cottage industry so that they could justify manifest destiny. It's a good way of saying it. So that all Native Americans are actually ancient Jewish people who migrated across North Africa, or maybe they left from like Yemen or something like that. But they migrated somehow to the Americas and landed in like Venezuela, I think is where they believe that it occurred. And that they found not only that another group before them had done this also and landed up in like New York or South Carolina or something like that. And so then that there had completely populated this nation or this continent, and that, so then all Native Americans are actually just Jews, who, then you can just reclaim them to Judeo-Christianity and you don't have to feel bad about it because you're bringing them back into the fold, right? This is what should supposed to happen for them. The reality, of course, anthropology has learned, is that Native Americans have been here since they migrated mostly over Beringia. Some groups have come across on boats from both the Old World and from the western side of the Old World and from the eastern side of the Old World, and possibly on boats or like big dugout logs or something like that, which is that's a boat. But anyways, that somehow they made it to. There are several landing points and possible points of origin according to the archaeology and the anthropology that's been done on it at this time. And not saying that that paints a complete picture, but it definitely is pretty solid work with good date ranges, I believe, for what you're looking at. Some of it's more solid than others, and of course, the most solid one is the trip across Beringia and down the Pacific coast. But here's one thing that a lot of people don't know about the Arctic Circle is that in the Arctic Circle, their culture sphere has existed there for all of that time. People mastered living in the Arctic, and they've been living in the Arctic with about, a relatively comprehensive and similar technological toolkit. That's what they call it. It's a technology level. Basically, it's a set of items that help them master their environment. That they've been living in that area that way all this time, and that includes hopping from this side to the other side. So it's not that far from, Alaska to Russia, Siberia, especially if you go across the top. And if you have mastered that, then you can. So that what I'm saying is that there have always been people who have gone back and forth between the two continents. That the people who really provided a connective link of culture, language, genes, all kinds of things have been there the whole time on the top of the world, and that they have brought things from Asia to the New World and vice versa. Probably, I would not say probably, I would say absolutely without a doubt. For thousands of years before, before Teotihuacan even, okay? Before corn was genetically modified from teosinte, in central Mexico approximately 10,000 years ago. It's like 7,000 years ago or something like that. I don't remember. Or 13,000 years ago, excuse me. 12,000 years ago, something like that. At any rate, and then it's a range. Anyway, so bam, you just got a whole extra piece that you didn't even want to know about. Anthropology. Don't you love it? So good points for bad religions is Mormons, despite having things that just cannot be believed. Like, oh, by the way, the thing that I wanted to say was that Tai Chi has come across that thing, and Tai Chi has existed already in the New World. It's part of Native American spirituality. I just want to say that real quick. Okay, so Mormonism has some good points. It's got selling points even in the world today. Even with, and actually, this is another good point for anthropologists and people who talk about evolutionary theory and adaptive patterns that are, favorable, that give you ultimate net reproductive success, which is what it's all about, right? So if you're Darwinian in your thinking and in your approach to life, there's nothing you could be that would be better than Mormonism. Mormonism will survive anything. It will survive the collapse of the United States. It will survive a nuclear fucking war. Mormonism is intractable. It is so strong. And it's like joining another nation within your nation, which is a comment on Judaism that I tried to make before all the time. Judaism is the original platform for communism. It's the original platform. And I'm not talking about communism like, so that's another one of those words that's like it's colloquially loaded with all these kind of words, things, connotations. People believe it means things it doesn't mean. But what one group, 1820s, back when Joseph Smith had this cottage industry of displacing Native Americans by saying that they came from Africa with no scientific authority whatsoever. He also was a predecessor in a lot of ways to Karl Marx. And there were a lot of predecessors to Karl Marx. There's the social equality has been on every civil equality and social equality has been in people's minds for ever since Hammurabi, really. People have never liked living under the yoke of the law. Mormonism effectively flaunts a lot of the horrors of living in the world today. You have to give up your intellectual dignity. Yes, you have to do that. And that's, whatever, but it's an easy trade for all these other things that are great benefits. Like Glenn Beck says, I came for the women and the food, man. Like, Mormonism creates an insular community around you that is so strong that you are absolutely secure. Your life is really, really good when you grow up Mormon in comparison to what it would be if you didn't, in a lot of ways. Lots of friends, you have, the food's great. There's, the relationships between the kids are really well defined so that there's less stress. Incidences of all kinds of horrible things happening to people, like getting all kinds of diseases and, into trouble. For females, your chances of getting raped are significantly lower if you're Mormon than if they are if you're not. Because Mormon girls are always around other Mormon people, and they're never in positions where they're not. It's just there are all kinds of reasons why I would make that claim for people who think that that's an outrageous claim. It's not an outrageous claim. It's probably you could do studies on it, and I would think that you would get, with 100% accuracy, you would get exactly what I just said. You would find that there, your chances of living longer and having a happier life are all better if you join Mormonism. But like I said, Mormons are not true Christians. They don't follow Jesus. They pretend that they do, and they make a pretty good show of it. But ultimately, they're the same racist, right-wing, hateful people. They believe in the subjugation of others to pay their bills, and their sons will join the military. They will militant pacifism, I've told you, is an absolute prerequisite for authentic Christianity. Really, militant pacifism in general is an absolute, and except for maybe Jews. Jews are maybe the only group that doesn't have. Well, Muslims is it's kind of like half and half, but certainly, if you have Jesus, it's absolutely pacifism, and if you have Paul, it's absolutely militancy. And that's why I said there's no, you can't compare the teachings of Jesus to Paul. And so Mormons haven't figured this out, and I'm just telling you, a good point for Mormonism is that they have an absolute rock-solid social network that can't be broken. And it provides people with all kinds of benefits. And that's a component that if you could distill that out and remove that and apply that to other groups that weren't racist, ignorant, head in the sand, ostrich, insular, elitist, consumptive, overwhelmingly entitled white, pigs. And if you think that that kind of language is inappropriate, you go to a Mormon church, look at the men on Sunday in the chapel while they're having their meeting and their kids are all crying around and their fucking organ and their music sounds like shit. Go there and look at the men. You will see them. They will be fucking, their necks are gonna be rolling out of their collars while they sweat and they're red. You know what I'm saying? And they look like fucking pigs. And so if you think that that's an unfair assessment, it's because you haven't been there, all right? And I was born into it. That's my father. So sorry, Dad, but if you're watching, you're not. I know you're not. But anyways, the next one is Catholicism. I was obviously not born Catholic. I would have almost liked it if I had been, but Catholicism is kind of been dead for so long. It hasn't been a living, breathing religion. It's really not a religion of the United States. Mormonism has all these. The reason that they have their own state is because they're such great communists. Catholicism, though, their whole point, and I'll just make this real quick because this video is already getting long, is that they're always open. That's awesome. So I'm saying, like, you don't have to have those bad components of these places. If you wanted to recreate a new place without these problems, you could like believe in anthropology as it was presented, and you wouldn't have to fake your, relationship with Jesus in the face of the people that you hang around with. And and they're always open, and they're providing life for you, food, friends, safety, warmth, you know, good things, a cultural hall to play basketball in. If those things were there and they were always open, you know, that would be revolutionary.